So everybody that wasn't behind the house today didn't get to see the lovely experience back there. And then everybody that was behind the house didn't get to see everything on this side. So you've seen a lot go up, or at least you see the end result. Where we left off, I think, was close to buttresses. So now everybody has a pretty good idea what buttresses are, or at least the form. Been filled with concrete. You have your bolts, hopefully, are in the side over there where Brett is standing. You'd like to display the lag bolts or the...
Style.
There you go.
Thank you. Thank you.
So that's going to receive the can wall. Plywood, all the wood's coming down. You can see back at the back how it was attached. Look at that nice detail. And again, going back to how the batter was, you see all the cardboard and different things that was there to plug the recesses. And it seems like it held without any cross bracing or front bracing, so, which is a pretty good task. I mean, it's a tough thing to do. So whoever was involved in the pour will be able to see how good their work is when that form comes off.
That was me.
Because of your agitation, you'll see whether or not it has these pockets in it.
Mm-hmm.
See that? And sometimes we pour them in sections. We'll do like a third of it or half of it, and then we'll pour another one, and then come back, and then you'll get to see that seam. So if you don't agitate real well, then you get these air pockets. And so that's what you're trying to eliminate when you are agitating.
Will those be exposed at all?
Well, they're going to be plastered over, okay. So it'll all be slick and sexy. And
so how deep are the rebars running into the columns all the way through? The back?
No, there's rebar going vertically, but those just go in probably 3-4 inches.
Oh, okay. Just to catch the wall when you...
Yeah, just to tie into the wall, that's it. Pack out, you see that going on. Stabilizes the wall, and who did that? Who was the mean machine over there?
That was me.
Talk to us about it.
Well, it was the one can, and the two cans. Put enough concrete on there so that the cans aren't showing, then put another layer on top of the other two cans, and no further out than the face of the tires.
There you go.
And it basically just takes up space so that the plaster can fit nicely over it.
Scott was doing part of the first phase and that pack up.
What's that?
Scott was doing part of the first phase of the pack up.
Oh yeah, but that was yesterday.
Yeah.
And what else did you learn? Gravity today? Because Scott was now promoted to the top of the building, and he shared his knowledge on gravity because he learned that yesterday.
I've also learned how to clean concrete out of my hands.
I have.
As
you can see, the plumbing wall and the systems gang has been keep going and going and going, and it's all coming together. Can't really go into much detail. I mean, we could go out and figure out all the different components and things, but it's really not that critical. What else exciting did we do then? You guys have a good grasp on the bond beam as far as that goes. You guys have a better grasp, most of you, for the can laying, understanding the two fingers and how that works into structure. Minimum of one finger between the cans, which we really don't care for because you guys have built the bond beam. You understand how we're trying to reach a certain height and then your patty thicknesses. And everybody that laid cans with me the last 2 days has a pretty good understanding of the expectation. The end result, did we meet it? I think we did. So good job for everybody that worked on the bond beam. And then pouring it on top of fresh cement is very difficult. It's you have to be very gentle. And it's pushing everything you know we do, we push to the maximum, the max. And we go fast, quick, try to be efficient, but then there are some setbacks when you rush like that. So, but it's nothing that we can't overcome, and you guys are strong enough and big enough to move all that dirt again. So. The water board, what you see there, is going to be placed right about there. That's the whole nerve center for your water. Water coming in. First filtration, I think, is about a 60 mesh filter, and might be a 500 next, and then 1,000 is the third one. So your water, as it goes in, gets basically, after it goes into the cistern, before it goes in the cistern, there's a gravel, which is a form of filtration, because the dirt's going to settle to the bottom with the gravel. You just clean those out, a couple times a year. And then the water goes up over. You'll see that when we get to that part. But the water goes into the cistern, so that's your first form of filtration. Then it comes into the first filter, and it's just getting the big chunks. And then you want to clean, you want to have the big chunks out before it goes through your pumps. And these pumps are like incredible. They're all over the world, and they can digest just about everything after the 60 mesh filter. You have a pressure switch above that, and that's a new thing we're doing. The pressure switches in these pumps, sometimes they come already built to the pump, and sometimes they just don't know when to shut off because it gets close to the end of where it's charging, you know, fully charging the system, and they're confused. They don't know, am I supposed to shut? Because it feels the back pressure, and then all of a sudden there's, you know, an air bubble. And then it keeps going, and it takes longer. So what we've done is we've basically bypassed the pressure switch on the pump and put another one on to take it away from the pump, and then it senses it better. Because the pressure switch is like right in where the water goes through. So that's what we've done with advancement. There's a bypass valve above the pump. There's a blue handle there, or blue knob, whatever. And in the position it's in now, it's going into bypass. So you could gravity feed your house. If your pump's not working, if you don't have power, whatever, you bypass, and it'll gravity feed. The next filter is, like I said, it's probably a 500, maybe a 250. I'm experimenting with mine. I have a 500 and have one in for a long time, but it just filters too much stuff.
Are you talking microns?
I call it mesh because I don't think it's micron. I don't think it is micron because that's like 500 micron. You couldn't get anything through it. Then your water goes into, from that second filter, then your water, that's all your house water from there. Because you can use the water, you don't need it to be, you know, crystal clear, perfect water to bathe. And, you know, I mean, I boil water every day when I make tea at home. And I just use regular, you know, what we call regular tap water is water that hasn't been filtered for drinking. That's what we call regular tap water. A lot of guys don't even bother with the last two filters, and you know, a lot of people we live with are just content. I don't have any problems with it. I drink it a lot, you know. I don't care.
So that's what happened.
Phil's been drinking it without the filters, I can tell you that. I think I'm messed up. So then that's your fresh water supply, and then after that it goes into a 1,000 mesh filter. And that's the real deal, because then you're getting the real fine stuff, and then you go into your last big filter unit there, and that's your ceramic filters. And those are, you can clean those yourself also, so it's a maintenance system, but it's reusable, you know what I'm saying? It's recyclable in its own self that you just, the Rusco filters, the first three filters, they'll go forever. And you just take, you know, like if you don't want to do a lot of maintenance that month or whatever, you just blow them out at the bottom. You just let the system go, hook up, you know, put a bucket or a hose on it and just let it fly. And that's, you flush them that way. You can just flush them in place. And then a lot of us, you know, if you don't go maybe 2 months, you might, depend on what kind of, probably here it won't be too bad, but we live in the desert basically, and the dirt's always blowing all the time. So we have a little bit more maintenance, but that's just where you are. And then, so then the last big filter, that's your drinking water, and there'll be drinking water taps next to your spigots, you know, your sinks, all of the places wherever there's a sink, usually, there's a drinking water spout. So that's how that goes.
All the water pumps are 12 volts?
Yeah. Yeah. And that one's just, that's the pump for just the regular water, just for the house water. And then the other pump will be mounted in the greenhouse for the planter water. So when we see that, we'll talk about that.
So is this place set up just for the one bathroom?
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's all I wanted. Right, John? Just one bathroom?
Kitchen.
Yeah. Bathroom, kitchen, utility space behind it.
But there will be another shower outside over here.
Mm-hmm.
And hot and cold.
What's up? What's that?
Why?
Why what? The plastic? Jeez.
Yeah, that's
it. I don't know. I can leave it there.
Yeah.
I didn't do this. Who did this? Which one of you guys said this? See? Nobody's admitting to it. I didn't do it. Yeah. So as we talked about window boxes, we saw some of the door boxes go up first. Now we have the window boxes in place. And then you see the plating we talked about. There's the first plate. There's your 2x4 or your 2x8 underneath. And And then we created our own beams, as you see. We normally get full-on beams, you know, full beams, which are really light. And we always lift those up by hand. So these are just laminated. These are fabricated beams. So there's 4 2x10s glued and nailed together. And this is a standard way to build. This is not something new. It's basically just an engineered beam is all it is. And then the double plating on top. And you see these little red arrows, heads, or the carrots? That's where your vigas are going. So the layout for the vigas are all ready. It's all ready. So we're going to finish this plate that's back here. When we finish the plate on Sunday, most likely, the vigas will be on the roof on Sunday, by Monday when you come in, hopefully.
How are those
going to
be?
Well, I don't know. Those little circus peanuts, you know? No, we'll get to that. You'll see it. We won't get into that because it's ugly and it's painful.
And that's why we don't get to see it on Sunday?
No, it just happens to be that we usually work an extra day a week, and then it just happens to be that's where we are in the build. Maybe we'll see it on Monday after all. You know, we don't know. What else? Let's see what. See the vault going on down there? Everybody came through it. Maybe you didn't see it because you're looking to keep the duck your head sign.
Well, I felt it.
You felt the duck your head sign?
Yeah,
the vault.
Yeah. So I didn't see it.
It's supposed to be wearing a helmet.
And so the vault is what it is. It's just an archway, an entryway, and then it'll just finish. You know, some of you might have been involved with that. Were you? Anybody involved with that? You saw the little spit technique that Mike created?
Yeah, I got hit with it.
There you go. it's just taking the plaster, the mortar, and you sprinkle it on kind of more or less, because if you take like a big bucket and just dump it, you will watch the lath just go poof.
Okay, yeah.
Because it's structurally sound. It's just you need a light coat on it, get a nice thin film on it.
A little bit at a time.
Right, a little bit at a time, and then the same thing on the underside. The underside is going to get plastered, eventually, but you take turns, basically. You'll get a couple hits on top, get it solid, and then after maybe one, maybe two solid hits, then somebody can actually get on top of it. Lighter people, smaller people, we can put you up there and just say go to town, and if you fall through, say it's your fault.
Remember that waiver you signed it.
But then it's just no time, just then you're on the inside doing this, so. You remember the plaster, right? You told me the other
day. Oh, yeah.
So that's so like when you, how different is that from when you do like the plaster on the insides here? Is it still the spit technique kind of, or is it more
No, once you get your first coat on, when it stays, you know, you got something grabbing it and making it stronger,
uh-huh.
Then you're just going to plaster with a trowel and a hawk.
Okay.
And put material up there, and you just kind of squint a little bit and keep your mouth shut because it's going to fill up.
Yeah.
It's probably going to fall off.
Yeah. So you'll get to see that, and you'll be involved in it, obviously. I don't want to take you out back, but there's nothing to see. It would have been nice, but no. What else do we have? Anything? What else do you guys do today that I can't remember? Did anybody do anything today?
We dug out at the bottom of the pipes, the cooling tubes.
Tell me
we
about
dug down about 2x2x2, and then they're going to fill it with gravel. And we were doing that essentially because when it pulls in that hot air is going to dump all the moisture in it, uh-huh. And it's going to run back in there. So where does that water go? That's why we built
right.
A little pit.
Absolutely. There you go. I didn't know that. What else did you guys do today that I don't know about? Ed, did you do anything today?
Had lunch.
Good.
So I can test.
Very good. I had lunch.
Mixer?
Yeah.
Mixer? Everybody's had a shot at the mixer?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
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 Sort of.
You saw it. Okay. Mixing's good. I mean, those who have mixed and everybody who's received the mix has seen every mix possible probably made in 4 or 5 days. So you can see if you've made it, you know how difficult it is to make the perfect batch, and you've also been on the other end, how easy it is to work with the imperfect batch. And so you have to make it happen. That's the key thing. You know, all these things, we're seeing the difference of spending more money or not spending more money is really what it comes down to. And that's the whole idea, is to keep it low cost. Mm-hmm. And so you get as efficient as you can. And despite what you thought on Monday, you've learned a lot of techniques and skills that you never had before, or maybe you did, but you forgot. You're like us, we've had them, but we don't use them. But so now you can do everything. There's nothing here, again, once again, I quote, there's nothing here that you can't do. You can't do it. Once everything's here, you can do it. You may not feel real sure about it, but then think about it. Day one, you didn't feel real sure about things, but now I think everybody feels confident about time and time and how the house, how it relates to the house, the structure is actually built. You know, day one, you're just pounding tires. Day five, you can look at it and say, oh, I get it now. Mm-hmm. If we explained all this stuff and how it all works day one, we'd still be on the first course of tires. Same like everything else. And I told you the other day, it's going to be the same thing. We're going to go on the next phase, and you're not going to be told anything. You're just going to be told to do it, and you're going to do it, and you're going to learn. Mm-hmm. And we have multiple experiences where people have learned from being able the opportunity to do it. If we told you what happens when you do the back burn the way we did it and it collapses, then you're like, yeah, I get it. It's more better when you get it, your first-hand experience. So vigas will go up. Plating's done for the most part. It started.
Are those vigas, are they local?
No, we got those from New Mexico. They're cheaper. Well, let's say they're less expensive.
It was cheaper to buy in there and truck them all the way out here?
Yes, they were. And the shipping was ridiculous on them. It was only $1,400.
What kind of wood are they?
Probably a fir. They're standing dead. What they call standing dead is a tree that's dead. Uh-huh. So they don't cut live trees.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so they're pretty seasoned for the most part, so they're dry. They're a lot lighter than most of the stuff we use. I mean, it doesn't matter. We don't care.
Right.
Nothing's heavy to us, right?
But yeah,
nothing we can't get you to lift, right?
You're going to bring a crane in to set it.
No, we're going to probably use the backhoe, and then it's going to be a lot of manpower. So we'll do it. We'll get them all up.
You
going
to roll them like you did?
Absolutely. So
how
we'll
many
do.
Have
yeah.
I'll want to see any of that.
All on one.
Maybe 36. I'm not real sure.
How far apart are they spaced?
Depends.
There you go. And we do it also with each space. Like, you could run the whole house from one end, set your 2-foot spacing all the way across the house, but then you would have a viga possibly in the middle of a wall or halfway between a wall. So then you would have, the viga would be like encroaching into one room, and then it would be real slight in the other. So it would kind of give the room an off-balance look. You know, you'd walk in and you're like, oh, that was really cheap. You know, and then you'd walk on the other side of the wall and you'd be like, oh man, that's really cheap. So we split them up for the rooms so that they're in conjunction with the rooms. And then if there's one in the middle, you know, like in between, we want to get it in between the rooms. So we tend to shift them per room. It doesn't change anything with the structure at all. The code, or not the code, but these are, the spacing varies on the vigas as to the diameter of the viga. So if you get something like this, you're probably going to have all vigas
as
your brick. So when you get to the 13, 14-inch vigas, then that gives you the latitude to spread them out. And this style is a New Mexico or a Southwestern style. People like it, and it's a very easy way to build the house.
Mm-hmm.
And when those have seen it, Matt's seen it, Ed, I don't think you've seen it. Have you seen us put vigas on?
Yeah,
and then Brett has. It's not that, I mean, it's a big task, but it's 2.5 hours. We can put it on by hand.
Yeah, it really is surprising. I mean, when I saw the timbers at first, I thought, you know, there's no freaking way. That's what I thought, and then you put them on so quickly.
And then five of us installed.
Yeah, Rory can put them on by himself.
Yeah, now he doesn't. So one thing he doesn't do.
What day are you guys, I understand we are supposed to work Monday to Friday, but when are you, you said you're going to be working Saturday and or Sunday?
We're working Sunday.
Okay. So Saturday you're not going to be here?
No.
Sunday?
I'm not, Ed. No, you're going to miss me.
I miss you all the time.
I know.
Other than that, you guys are going to be here Sunday, 8 in the morning to 4
o'clock? Yeah, we do Sunday. We primarily do days. We don't encourage you guys to work because, you know, you guys put in a hard week, and this is what we do. And so you get your 2 days rest. We try to make up a day, and then it gives us a chance to not just work together, but for us to kind of like, we can focus on things to, you know, like two of us can go do things that we have to send maybe five of you to do or something. So we can kind of focus on things, maybe get caught up or get to a place where we want to get, You know, we just do focused attacks on things so that we can get to another place so that when you guys come back, because it's hard, as you know, to orchestrate keeping people busy, this many people busy, and I think we've done pretty good so far. You guys have been hiding for a long time. So it's just one of those days we try to get a little bit more technical, and it's not, I mean, not more technical, just try to get more focused, and then we don't have to spend as much time, you know, explaining and doing things, because it's difficult to do that, as you guys can imagine. Hopefully you can. Or you guys think we're real difficult.
Is it typical to get this much done in a week?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Very typical. And the weather's been very, you know, good for us. We've been fortunate for that, and that's the biggest thing is your weather. And then, you know, machine breaks down or something like that, that immediately...
Wall-fall.
Oh, that's nothing. That's nothing. I mean, when the machinery breaks, guess what? You know?
It's all us.
So
the generator, right?
These guys, the guys have been with us enough times, know we do everything by hand. We're not stuck to these machines. So yeah. And we would still do it in about the same time. It doesn't change. We're sick. We're not well. Neither are you guys. It wasn't like we didn't get much done since Wednesday, you know, but it's just, you can see what it takes to get to this point. What else can I tell you? Yeah, the cisterns, just, I mean, we wanted to be further along with that, but it just didn't happen. So.
It's very close. They were leveling it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
We got very close.
Very close.
Very close.
So close. But, yeah, it's all good.
If I may ask, John, is this what you were expecting to see the first week? Are
no.
we behind? Are we ahead? You said you wanted to move next week.
Ahead.
You want to move in next week? So what do you think about your house so far?
No, I take that one.
That's the best we can ask for.
Yeah.
So I imagine the cool air, you know, you open the vents and then the cool air comes through the back too. The hot air.
Well, it can be cool. It depends on if you're.
If it's right now, it's going to be cool. But I mean, in the summer, the idea is for the summertime to cool down. You're not going to bring cool air in the winter. You will in Georgia, of course.
Yeah.
But anywhere else in the world, you probably. I mean, but, you know, winter, that's for the summertime to get the cool, you know, you just convert hot air to cool air, and then you're just using natural convection to force the hot air out that's in the house.
Okay.
So you're just exchanging air, and airflow is so critical to any kind of house. And most, you know, if you don't have cross ventilation in a house, you're going to die.
Yeah.
And so this does a great, this, even though we may not have a full-on end, you know, like you don't have another window down here and a window down here to, you know, it's just not necessary.
Yeah, this wall fully makes up for that. So I guess, like, you know, if you wanted to keep the whole thing warm, like, could you, for instance, like, put blinds or shades on these windows? Like, would that prevent it from warming up?
Yeah, oh, yeah, we do. I have blinds and full blinds that cover the complete glass on my front slope glass.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, because I don't have this wall. And I have blinds, just regular Douglas, 100 Douglas blinds.
Mm-hmm. So you do that when you got it warm enough and you just don't...
Well, in the wintertime, I mean, you know, let's just picture Taos at 20 below zero. The sun comes up, you roll your blinds up.
Right.
Let your solar gain happen. Evening time, you're not getting any solar gain, and all you're going to do is put a barrier between the extreme temperature outside, because what happens, it's a war that goes on. The cold air attacks your house.
Right.
And then all your bricks or your adobe, all your tires and everything that soaked up that sun during the day says... you're not coming in.
Mm-hmm.
And so it starts combating, and about midnight, you have to open up your skylights because you're sweating. Because this battle becomes serious about midnight. And you'll be laying there, and you're, it's kind of cool. It's winter, you know, you don't worry about winter. It's cool anyway, you know. And then all of a sudden, you're like, covers are off. You know, and I have a window that I open up in February in my house, and I don't close it. I only have it closed from December to February.
Yeah.
That's when you have like -30 Fahrenheit, right?
Yeah.
And those tubes, from the way I understand it, I mean, they can heat your house too.
They can, but you're not gonna. It's not gonna be a heating process, because when are you gonna heat your house in the summertime?
Well, but I mean, but say the air outside is 5 degrees, and the air in those tubes is 60 or whatever the temperature of the air.
Yeah, you're not gonna
it's
do
not gonna
that.
Heat that air.
No, because you're gonna be sucking in cold air probably. You have a serious cold air coming in the house. So.
Mm-hmm. So
So it's like the same concept as, like, you know, you're driving down the highway in the middle of winter and it's very cold outside, but with all the windows up, it starts to get hot, so you just, like, crack the side window.
Mm-hmm. Mine's wide open.
Yeah,
it's amazing. It works that way, you know. And I have a two-story, too, so I'm talking about a window on the upstairs unit.
Okay.
Then I can suck all the heat out of my house in winter, too, doing that. So it's you have to learn, you have to become active in your day-to-day living.
Mm-hmm.
You really respect that thing right there. When it doesn't come up, you know, it's just, you know, you understand life better when you're engaged in your day-to-day life. You know, you're keeping track of how much water you have, how much you're going to use day-to-day. It's not meaning you're doing without, it's just you're not wasting.
Yeah.
You're conscious. You're totally conscious of what you're doing. Yeah. If you're not, guess what? You don't have any water. You don't have any power. And that's the thing. That's how you survive. You know, if you don't stay on top of it. So in your conventional house, you don't care because it's an endless supply of water, right? Because as long as you have money, you have water, right?
Yeah.
Because you're paying for it.
Yeah.
Is it like,
if you don't have money, you start to care.
Does it like end up evening out, like, say? Do your batteries have a certain capacity where, like, you store a whole bunch of energy over, like, summer and then you just use, like, a rationed amount?
No, batteries can't hold energy that long. They can't store it.
Okay.
So it's a continuous replenishment use cycle, right?
Okay.
Now, let's say you have 3 days of overcast skies. Your solar water heater is probably going to be lukewarm. You know, your water's going to be lukewarm after about 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
And that's with 20 below zero.
Yes.
Okay. Here, it would probably be pretty decent.
So it's still getting enough light if it's overcast?
Oh, no, I'm not saying it's just the opposite. Let's say you just had beautiful days of sunshine. We don't care what the temperature is.
Right.
It can be minus 65.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It's just the light.
As long as the sun's hitting the panel, because it's a black panel, it's receiving it, and then boom, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But then after 3 days of clouds, you start losing those things, you know. And so then you become more manager, you know, you manage your, but then you have to forecast, you know, you look at the weather and say, okay, it's going to be snowing for 3 days. I have a pretty good idea that I might
smell that bad.
If I want hot water, then I need to boil, you know, or something.
Yeah.
So that's it. There's Phil. He'll be glad to entertain a lot of questions.
I miss it.
No, you are it.
Are you guys just going to run solar panels out here for your farm?
There's the guy.
Just gonna do panels, or
wind is affected by the trees, you know, and stuff. So then you would have to go really high in this area. I mean, I imagine you get some pretty good breezes here, but the wind does knock it down, and so it creates what's called a burble. When you have like the back of a semi while you're driving down the road, and you pull behind a semi, and you just get tossed around.
Mm-hmm.
And the trees do the same thing, and burble is not good. You don't want your propeller on your airplane spinning and getting erratic.
Right.
So in order to do that, you got to get above where the...
Has to be unimpeded.
Well, not completely, but... Yeah. So here, it would be difficult. You may not get enough sustained wind to be beneficial.
Right.
And then the only way to do that is keep going up, and then...
It gets cost ineffective, I guess.
Could be. Cost prohibitive, I think.
Cost not working.
Or you could lease your land out to
it. But it could be a really cool thing you got on your house. And everybody's impressed with it, but it doesn't do anything. You had one of those, didn't you, Frank?
What's that?
A wind generator? That's it for me. Whatever. I don't know what to tell you.
Mike can be mean.
Ed, you know where it comes from.
All right, yes, I know.
You're my next tattoo. So yeah, great job, and we'll see what we got Monday.
Thank you, Mike.
Right. Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
here.